Filmatics and High Moguls. Today, we have a very special guest, Michael S. Emerson. We are going to learn how to finance films. So I really want you to listen to the podcast. But first, I just want to introduce you to Michael. He is a writer, producer, creator, director of shows like Newsmax TV series, An American Moment, An American Life. And he's also the producer director for History Channel, 6-hour television miniseries, Vietnam in HD, and History's historic Emmy award-winning 10-part series, World War II in HD, and then the 2-hour special, The Air of War. Let's welcome Michael S. Emerson to the show. Hi, Michael.
Oh, hi, Marilyn. Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, it was a little big mouthful, but you've done so much, like director, producer, amazing shows on the History Channel. And I just want everyone to know, where are you streaming with me live today on the podcast?
I'm sorry, I didn't get that last part. Where am I what?
Where are you streaming? Where?
Oh,
are you streaming?
I'm from my home. I live in Orange County, and I'm sitting in my work area where I write a lot of my scripts.
Yeah, like most of us, if we didn't return to work, we've been working out of our home. So we've been doing the Zoom or the Google Meet. And so today, you know, before we get into how to finance films for aspiring filmmakers, how do you make films? I first want to just start with, like, you know, Michael, growing up, what was one of your favorite films as a child that you remember?
You know, it's difficult to leave it to one. Please understand, I grew up during the Western era. So I grew up with television and motion pictures being primarily Western. And because of that, I fell in love with a lot of Western movies such as Searchers, John Wayne, a classic, another one, The Wild Bunch, which is a classic motion picture. But I also, at the same time, I love a picture called The Train, which was Burt Lancaster. It's a black and white. And it's a picture about a true story in Paris during Nazi-occupied France, and they were trying to save the French artworks from being confiscated by the Germans. As the true story is very well made, it's in black and white, which always surprised me, but it's an excellent motion picture, so much so I keep it recorded, and I periodically look at it. And then I guess my last, to confuse you even more, I loved the 2004, 2005, there was a picture called The Legend of Zorro, and it was by Martin Campbell, I think was the director. And what really interested me in that picture, as a director, he had incorporated some really interesting, I thought really interesting techniques, visual techniques, which were not special effects, they were just creative directing techniques. So I periodically watch films like that to re-inspire some of, so I can get ideas to copy other people. Take all the credit for it. Copy other people, you know. Typical producer, director, Hollywood. You know?
So can I ask you, so The Legend of Zorro, what were the directing techniques that you loved in that film?
Because we there's actually several. First of all, keep in mind, I'm a producer-director. And so at the same time, cost of motion pictures, the time it takes to shoot a motion picture, the time it sets for everything else, means something to me. And I'll give you one example, a very simple technique that he used, which added a second dimension to his picture. And maybe I'm using words that mean something to me, maybe nobody else. But in the very opening sequence of it, where the bad guys are getting ready to kill somebody and they think Zorro's coming to save them, the camera follows two young boys who jump into the back of a wagon and cut open two circles in a canvas wagon that gives them the perspective what they're looking at. It's a simple technique. It didn't require a whole lot of setup. It didn't require a whole lot of props. And the fact was, it gave you a different visual dimension in the middle of all this action. And I can convert that to one other thing too. John Ford, the legendary director, certainly before my time. John Ford is a legendary director, but John Ford would do things. If you ever watch a John Ford movie, the difference between his brilliance and the brilliance of other directors is that everything in the movie, everything in the scene told a story. I'll give you an example. There was a John Wayne picture John Wayne is surrounded by an Indian tribe ready to kill him. And they're all on horses, right? Well, in a normal motion picture, a normal director, those horses would be standing there with these warriors on top of them, not with John Ford. Those horses were in constant movement, their legs come moving, and it built the energy of the of that particular scene so effectively. And I think that that's what you saw in Zorro as well, the very beginning of that, so much action. It's one thing to shoot action. It's another thing to shoot action that actually drives the anxiety up. And it's a technique, and I respect that, and I try to learn from it.
Yeah, so it's... Is John Ford one of your favorite directors then as well? Or
actually, there would be several. I'd have to say, and honestly, and the director that's most important to me was my mentor. And he's a director that you probably may or may not know. His name was Bert Kennedy. Bert was a writer-director. I did about 70 motion pictures and television shows, a lot of the Westerns. He was classic for that. A War Wagon, for instance, Kirk Douglas, John Wayne, Kirk Douglas. But Bert was a great guy, a special guy. I did a movie with him. I met him and producing a movie called Big Bad John. And we became close friends, and he's passed now, so God rest his soul. But he was really a mentor of mine. I learned so much from him. And for your potential directors that are listening to you right now, it's very important for you to direct, you know, to maintain control of a set. That is not very easy to do, especially when you have 60 to 80 people, all of them high paid. And he taught me that technique. And I've only had to use it a couple times, but it was highly, highly effective.
Oh, that's amazing. Yeah. And so what can you share with us your favorite director shot or film scene?
Again, I go back, but I told you a couple of them already. I think what it is, I come from a different background a little bit in that as a director, I understand that what you see on a film, what you see on a screen, what you see in television, it's not one person. It's just a group of highly specialized, talented people with lighting, for instance. Second director, you know, the first director, second director, the budget, the boarding of a picture, which is the planning of a picture. All these things go into that effect. So if you're asking for a specific, I can tell you that. I will tell you that, but you're not going to be impressed. It goes back. I did a biography on Cecil B. DeMille for the History Channel. It won several awards. But the technique he used in 1922 or something like that to part the Red Sea was unbelievable. It was jello and water. And I'm looking at that and I'm thinking, that's pure genius. So I'm sure there are plenty of events, certainly Spielberg is huge on this, everybody else. But when you have nothing to work from and you're using gelatin and water, and the scene works, it's, I think that was probably my best special effect.
I love that. Yeah, because you really cited some great examples from John Ford. And well, I'm sorry, what was the name of the Legend of Zorro's director you said?
Martin Campbell directed that. I don't know Martin, but I instantly recognize, you know, my wife says that I have no fun to go to a movie with anymore, and she's right. And I try so hard to just sit there. But invariably, I'll be looking at something and I'll go, great shot. Oh, wow, look at that framing. Oh, wow. You know, and my wife will say, shh,
shh. Look at that dog.
It's true. It is true. It's absolutely true. And I, but I learn from so much. I just see things differently, and it doesn't necessarily mean that's good.
Yeah. Speaking of like Zorro, I actually worked for David Foster, who did Zorro, you know, the modern Zorro at Paramount Studios. He's a very great guy, wonderful guy. He was working on a romantic comedy, and like me, he's like, oh, I already got one working with this writer, but I like yours better. So it was really great. I drove him around in the golf cart. I don't know if I was the best golf cart driver on the lot of Paramount Studios, but
it was fun. Did you say Paramount?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I guess that's not true. So it's the Western set wasn't there anymore when you did it. That was long gone. The old Ponderosa set was gone. It was the whole part of the lot was Virginia City. I used to love going through there, but no, now you have the modern back lot. I've been there.
I went through Dr. Phil's set a lot and met the editor who edited. He was generous enough to edit one of my short films. And so I would meet people they gave me stuff for my first film, which I got top 50 director in. I got Expendable. So thank you, Paramount. Appreciate them. So on this journey, like I'm like you, like I love the black and white films and I'm obsessed with Criterion films. Is there a Criterion film that you want to share with us as maybe one of your favorites?
Not really. I mean, I just can't think of them. There isn't a particular one. The key about black and white films is the lighting. And I learned very early on in my career how important lighting is. And you notice it even more so in black and white films than you do color films. And I also want to tell you that this will give you an insight. I work all day. I have several film projects, a television project. I go all day. This is a nice break in the day for me. But at the end of the day, how I relax is I have in my home sort of a big theater, 70-inch television, nice comfortable chair, and I watch old movies. I watch AMC. I watch, Turner Classic Movies. I watch the old movies. My wife thinks I'm crazy, but it's a way for me to just relax.
I love watching too. One of my favorites is Federico Fellini, all the Italian directors. When I just watch their incredible, just what they did back then with no special effects, but just like you said, like Cecil B. DeMille used Jell-O and water. The creativity that you come up with to make these, it's amazing. Like, and like when we had to use skateboards or grocery carts to do a dolly, and now we have the drones, and I'm like, oh, you have a drone. My neighbors have a drone. I'm like, I'm so jealous in a good way. Can I borrow it? They make some nice.
I did a show on the special effects guy that did Star Wars, and this was a huge. I had a little bit of insight to Star Wars when it was made. It's a huge motion picture, huge success, but they didn't know what they had, and their budget was running out. They're running out of money, and the guy went to the junkyard, and he put together the parts to build R2-D2 at a junkyard.
That's brilliant.
Most of the stories that Hollywood should be telling, I think.
R2-D2 came from a junkyard. Well, that's good recycling. That's great recycling. Great recycling. I love that. Yeah, R2-D2 and C-3PO and all the new characters. I can't even keep up with them. I mean, I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm so like feeling like, I don't know all these new characters, but I love my Chewie, Chewbacca, and just the.
I haven't seen the new episodes. Probably the last two or three I haven't seen. I was mesmerized by the beginning of them. I knew some of the information behind it. I can tell you some insight that probably no one will tell you about Star Wars. But George Lucas, as you know, that was his breakout. But 20th Century Fox did not know what they had. They thought they didn't know whether they had the biggest flop of the year or whether they had something special. And they turned to another mentor of mine who's also passed away. He was a number two man at Disney. His name was Dick McKay. And Dick just was in the industry. He was kind of noted to be able to look at a picture and get an idea within 10% what the picture would do worldwide, which is quite a asset. So they brought him in to look at it, and when they finished, they said, do we do this as a wide release? Now, back then, wide release was a way that you thought the picture was bad and that you would put the money out there and con everybody to go see it the first weekend before the word of mouth would kill it. And he said, no, don't do that. You have a great winner here. Do this what they call a platform release. Release it in select theaters. Let the audiences grow. And that's exactly what happened. He was absolutely correct. And the byproduct of that, if you remember, you're probably too young to remember this, but there was a Burt Reynolds franchise called he played the Bandit. The
Smoking
Bandit.
The Bandit.
Yeah, Smoking the Bandit. Smoking the Bandit was a low grade, inexpensive picture that Universal had made in as a requirement to do a Burt Reynolds movie. Burt wanted to help his friend, a director, and his name will come to me in a moment. But Burt said, if you want me to do these other pictures, I want to do this picture with my friend, the director. And they said, okay, it was a contract requirement. Well, what happened was the other movies that Universal, MGM, Paramount, and the rest, when Star Wars took over, they couldn't stand that competition. So they took their least pictures they didn't like very much, and they put them out there in contrast to Star Wars, because they had to deliver movies to theaters. They had a contract. They had to deliver theater movies. And so if one series of theaters had Star Wars, what were the rest going to play? Well, Smoking the Bandit filled that gap, and that's what made Smoking the Bandit so successful, is that it was the only picture they could put into theaters that opposite Star Wars. And so meanwhile, just by the mere fact of people, and you went to a theater. I remember I saw Star Wars twice. I saw it as a studio premiere at the studio, private showing. And then I had a date, and I went to see it. And I remember in Westwood, you go to it, and you couldn't get in. The theaters had lines around the block getting in, and therefore they filled the other seats with Smoking the Bandit, and that gave life to a legend that went on for 3 or 4 pictures.
Yeah, it's interesting how when you saw that movie, how could you just ask someone like, oh, is this going to be good? Like, how are you in the business at a studio and you don't know if a movie's good or not? Like,
nobody does. Nobody, honestly.
Yeah, honestly, like Star Wars, if you would have saw the first cut of Star Wars, it's like, wow, this is awesome. Like, how could you not come up with that? Like, you know what I mean?
Because there was nothing else there that like it.
It doesn't matter. You got to know good from bad. Like, I mean, that's what I take. Because, like, I was a reader for all these producers, and every single script that I told them was a winner was a winner. So I had the gift of knowing. So I guess I'm like your friend at Disney. I'm like your McKay. They got to come to me. You can pay me. I'll tell you whether or not it's going to be good or not. Because I have that gift. And not only that, I wrote scripts that would be almost identical to the scripts that they made at Disney or studios. And then everyone goes, isn't that like your script? So I have that gift. Like, I definitely have that gift. So anyone wants to ask me, I've got that gift. I just do.
It is absolutely a gift.
Yeah. And I say that with 100% confidence, because I read for, I was a literary junior agent. I read for producers and production companies. I read their scripts, and they would ask me which ones, and they would call me on Saturdays and Sundays when I wasn't working to read scripts and give them notes. So I've done this for years, and but you still, we're all working on our craft. We're all hoping to get monetized. And by the way, if everyone's listening, can you please hit the subscribe and 5 stars? And please subscribe to my YouTube channel. Just click in the summary below. Thank you so much. And so so this is really interesting. I love it, because you know so many people. And so it comes to, so I love Criterion, and you have all these, like The Train. I'm gonna watch The Train. It sounds amazing. And I want to see the Legend of Zorro, because we on here, we have so many people. We always ask for your favorite director shot, for director tips, because we always like to talk about our favorite film shots, directing shots, and our favorite scenes from movies. But so I want to ask you, Michael, where did you grow up? Oh, did you grow up in LA or Orange County?
I actually grew up in Beverly Hills.
Okay.
And I attended Beverly Hills Catholic School, and then moved on to Beverly Hills High School. I went to school with Richard Dreyfuss and Rob Reiner, and trying to think, a slew of others. But I didn't really get into the film or television industry. My degrees are in marketing and advertising. And I got into the media industry because back in 79 or something, I created a radio program. And the radio program was called Face to Face. It was an interview program with leaders of entertainment, business, finance, everything like that. And that program, that was my radio program. I started on 12 stations. And then I grew to 126 stations in the U.S. And then eventually I was picked up overseas and I went to 697 stations in 41 nations. And the show was heard every day, 5 days a week. But it was what they call a 5-minute slot. It was 3 minutes of content, 2 minutes of commercial. That's how I got started.
That's amazing. Now, Michael, I want to tell everyone first that Michael sent me, thank you, Michael, Mastering the Art of Media Messaging, Media Professional Michael S. Emerson. So can you get this on Amazon or, you know, online,
yeah,
your book?
Yeah, it's at Barnes & Noble, on Amazon, it's everywhere. It's all there.
Yeah, it's an amazing book and signed. Thank you so much, Michael. I want to ask you, Michael, radio was big back then. There was no such thing as a podcast. So I want to ask you, is there archives or where can they listen to those if they wanted to look up your radio shows?
It isn't. They are not available for listening. I have, it's an interesting thing because I have like 300 interviews with people like Menachem Begin and Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan and Donald Reagan and Shirley Temple and Bob Hope and people like that. And I was driving yesterday thinking about this is all stored. And I keep thinking I've got to coordinate this. I want to donate it to like the radio museum for future broadcasters to work on, but you cannot hear it.
Oh, well, maybe I can help you get it on the podcast and make a podcast for you. Maybe we can work on that. So because
well, I'll tell you, I'll send you, I have your address. I'll send you the demo tape that was made for the radio stations, and that'll give you an idea. And then you can, I don't really understand your field. I wish to God, I used to tell some people the other day, I wish to God when I was starting out, they had podcasts. I would have loved that. But right now my head is full of just motion picture intelligence stuff.
Well, maybe, we'll talk about off camera, but like audience, if you'd like, please comment. If you'd like to hear some of Michael's recordings, maybe he'll let me showcase them like once a month or something on Filmatics or Girls Guide to Investing. And I just want to share something with you, can we share this with you? One of your interviews, you were doing all these great interviews. Can you share with our audience the queen that you got? Can you tell them that story?
The queen? Oh, the queen. Yeah. Well, first of all, we're talking about the Queen of England.
Queen
Elizabeth. So what happens is this is a very interesting for your audience from the standpoint, the power of media. Media is probably the most powerful thing ever created by man or mankind. It is so powerful and it opens so many doors and does so many things. So what happens is, I need to point out to you, I'm Irish. My mother was born in Ireland and raised in England and then came here when she was 17 years old. So she's very proud of her Irish heritage. My radio program was heard all over the world, and I would be periodically the British consul, probably the British embassy in Washington, D.C., would constantly call me and say, look, when the next time you're in Washington, we have so-and-so here, Lord so-and-so here, the exchequer, which is their treasury secretary. We have all these people. Would you like to interview them? Of course. So I had they were a great source of information for me. So one day I get a request. And it says the Queen, Queen Elizabeth II, is coming to Los Angeles en route to meet with President Reagan at his ranch in Santa Barbara. Would you like to have lunch with her? And I said, and honestly, you have to understand, it's so stupid. I of course said yes, but I also was very, very, very busy. And as it turned out, that my wife. They couldn't clear her. They couldn't clear her on her security because they had wrong information, and I wasn't going to go without her. And she told me. She looked at me and she said that my mom would want me to go. So I went. I met with the Queen on board Britannia. It was in San Diego Harbor. It was an incredible experience. Britannia was an incredible yacht, 290 feet long, just absolutely beautiful. And at the same time, my mother had died about a year before. Mm-hmm. And when I was taken in to see the Queen's back was to me. And it was a little bit dreary outside, a little drizzly. And so I come up with something, you know, to say. And when she turned around, I swear to you, and I swear to your audience, she was the spitting image of my mother, the spitting image. My mother always wore a glove, the glove of the left hand, the purse of the left hand, the color hair, the hairdo, the light complexion, the deep blue eyes she had. And when she turned around, keeping in mind my mom had just passed, I almost grabbed her. You know, you can't touch the queen. And I wanted to just hug her and say, Mom, I mean, I'm telling you, I'm serious, dead serious. And then I caught myself and I said, Welcome to California, Your Majesty. And I looked outside, it was raining. I said, as you notice, we brought your weather with you so you feel at home. And she laughed and she said, I was trying to get away from that weather. That's my story with the queen. I should add, if I have a second, I'm looking for my clock here.
Oh yeah, we got about like 5 minutes. So I want to ask you, so the yacht was...
Let me just add this one thing I have to tell you. So when the queen leaves, I turn to leave, right? I turn to leave, and there's the queen travels, or with Britannia, her own destroyer, and she has all of the... She has a helicopter, her limousine, and all the sailors have special insignias that say, you know, her royal crest. So I turn around and there's this young man. I'm 6 feet. He had to be 6'2", 6'3". And he had to be like 18, 19 years old. He's holding this silver tray. And on it are these little bottles of Schweppes ginger ale. And I turn around and our eyes meet. So I'm looking up at him. And he's looking down at me. We don't say anything for about 15 seconds. And I look at him and I say, you realize there's no way I'm leaving this ship without something. And he says without missing a beat, he goes, and you'll notice, sir, that's why we removed all the silverware. Absolutely true. Anyway.
Well, I got to ask you, so the yacht was 293 feet. What did you have for lunch? Are you allowed to share with us? What did you dine on? Do you remember what you ate?
I don't. I was so taken with her. I was there with a couple other media people. Bruce Hershen's been a friend of mine, was there. Bruce's passed. But it was a beautiful day. And I, to this day, and by the way, I have at my home, in what we call the man cave, I had gotten an invitation. And the invitation, I know this by heart, the invitation says, the head of the household has been commanded by Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. To invite you for lunch on board the royal yacht Britannia. Business attire required. I remember that.
What kind of attire? What kind of attire did you have?
Business attire required. As if I was going to show up on a Speedo or something.
You know? Oh, I don't know. I was like, what do you wear? At least they told you. Like, was it like tea and crumpets? Did you have delicious cake? We're like, I'm such a girl. Like, no, did you have tea and crumpets?
No, it was like a typical lunch. It's sandwiches and stuff like
sandwiches.
That.
Oh, how nice. Like flowers and everywhere, the decorations and stuff.
Yeah, well, it was just beautiful.
What a beautiful, like that she, like, obviously they heard your radio shows and you did such great interviews. So you did so many with Bob Hope and so many wonderful people. We might have to come back and ask you about that. So we're going to end part one with Michael S. Emerson. Please come back for part two. We might even go to part three because I know our aspiring filmmakers want to hear how to finance films. We have so much fun stuff to talk about because Michael has been in the business so long. So thank you for listening. And remember to subscribe, hit the 5 stars, and please subscribe to my YouTube channel. It's summary, the information's in the summary. Thank you so much for listening and come back for part two.